would say just pick up the first number.
Thank you.
Today, Lord. Today, Lord, we ask that we don't finish up in your presence, but we start from your presence today. Father, Jesus said that he's the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Today I ask, Lord, that we don't start in our flesh and end in the Spirit. I ask that we start in the Spirit and end in the Spirit. So if you're with me today, could you just stand with me? I don't normally ask you to stand, but today I'm going to ask you to start from that position. Let's stand today in honor of the Lord, in honor of who he is. Thank you, Father. Praise. There's nothing happening in our lives, nothing that's going to happen in our lives that pales your light, that dims the brightness of your shining. And so today, Lord, no matter what we face, no matter what's in our past or in our present, Father, we decide today to lift up our hands and lift up our voices. Today we recognize the goodness and greatness of our God. We recognize he's worthy of praise. Would you join me in telling him he's worthy today? Would you join me past anything you're currently feeling? Let him know that you know how good he is. Let him know how good he is before you sing a song that tells you it. Declare his goodness over your life. You are good, Lord. Your faithfulness, your loving kindness, it endures forever. You are our reality. We don't bring our reality to you and ask you to fix it. We ask that you become our reality, Jesus. Become our reality. Become the greatest truth of our lives. You, Jesus, are truth. And we center you in the presence of everything else in our lives. And we ask that you begin to dictate from us all of the circumstances and situations in us. You're good. Tell him you're good. Shout over 2016 that God is good. Hey. Prophesy to your year. Prophesy to your days ahead. Remind them what truth is. Tell your days now who will order your steps. You are good.
Let the King of Miles be the mountain where Thank you. Dreams, bring them back to life. little bit ago, I just sat down and I closed my eyes just for a split moment, and I saw a honeycomb and covered in bees, and I thought, well, I guess that's us. But the thing about bees that I wanted to tell you is that when bees make honey, they make more than they need. And that's why people harvest honey from bees, because they make more than they need. And if they make too much, they just leave. And they leave it there. So don't ever worry about making too much or storing it up, because there's enough. And the thing about honey is it never goes bad. It's 100 years from now, you find a jar of honey, it's still honey.
Thank you. So I was thinking about that song as we go through it. And just saying, you know, you won't stop coming after me. And then I thought, well, maybe we could sing You Won't Stop Coming After Them. But I don't really like that because I don't like the whole us and them thing. So why don't we just say us? Because I feel like there's a lot of people right now that are really hungry for 2016, and they're not all here right now. He's never gonna stop coming after us. Coming after us. 'Cause your heart won't stop coming after us. 'Cause your heart won't stop coming after us. 'Cause your heart won't stop coming after us. Well, let's just do that one more time. God, we declare that your heart won't stop coming after us. 'Cause your heart won't stop coming after us. 'Cause your heart won't stop coming after us. That's a two-sided conversation where both parties are saying the same thing.
You seek me with all of your heart.
Thank you.
going to stop chasing after you. I'm not going to stop chasing after you. Because I know you never stop chasing after me. What a great song to start the year off. Who's ready for this year? Because if you're not, it's here. So we better be. I'm ready for a transforming year. I really am. You know, we need to, if we want to change some things in our lives, we need to start doing things differently. And only the Lord can change our mind to help us do that. Otherwise, we get stuck in the same habits. And I'm believing this is a year for me and for you and everyone that wants to start doing that for great things to happen. Especially, I'm tired of all my friends I hear today that aren't here. So, Lord, I pray for them to be better. Lord, I pray for your spirit to overcome them today, for healing to be in their bones and their body. And, Lord, I want to believe for everyone in here to walk in a transformational life this year, that we don't have to walk in any sickness anymore. And, Lord, in doing that, it's going to glorify you, Father. And we're going to take that to other people, Lord. Father, we love you. We don't want to stop chasing after you. The ushers want to come up.
A girl that I work with, she had stage 2 skin cancer, and she was telling me about it, and I said, you know, I said, God said, you're healed. I said, you are healthy and well and whole. And she looked at me and she said, well, I know, I believe that. But then one day she was driving into work and she claimed it over her life. And they removed some spots on her skin, and now, praise the Lord, she's healed.
Okay, children can be dismissed. Thank you. Happy New Year. Yeah, that's the right attitude. I'm getting over one of those things Chuck just prayed for. Oh, man, it has been a rough week. Physically. And I'm just believing that, you know, how there was something about how when a baby's born, they don't realize how much pain it takes to be born. Well, I'm believing 2016 took a lot of pain to be born physically in me. So I'm excited about the year that is to come. And I thought I'd share with you a little bit about some of the things that are in my heart for 2016. And I'm going to use the board to differentiate something here that I think is going to be helpful for some of us. Two things I want to talk about that are going to be happening is this Wednesday night is our vision night. Instead of our normal Bible study, we're going to have our vision night where I go into a little more detail, and some of us together will go into more detail about what we're seeing for the year, how we're going to lay out the year, what we're going to focus on for 2016. So that's Wednesday at 7 p.m. And then February is our next Sessions of Sonship weekend, February 18th through the 20th. Registration opens tomorrow. And does anybody want to give a quick testimony of why they should take sessions? Did I hear a sure? Nobody? Run up here, fast. There's a microphone on the table.
I feel like realizing who you are as a son is the most important thing you can ever do for your life. And this class, this sessions, it gives you an opportunity to do that. We all have that opportunity every day if we open our word. And if we, you know, in this way, this teaches you how to be a son. It teaches you who you are as a son. And it's changed my life. So it's the most important thing you can do is realize who you are in your Father's heart.
Thank you. So Thursday, starting in the evening on February 18th, and it goes through Saturday evening, February 20th. this one we are doing for ages 18 and above, mainly because you're going to be doing it all day on Friday, so if you can take off work. If you have more questions about it, you can ask me, but it is an intensive 2.5 days where you discover who you really are in the Father. So if it's anyone that might be interested in that, please talk to us. It starts on, registration starts on Monday, tomorrow. Okay. My thought for the year for 2016, and yeah, I'll just say it, and then we'll figure out how it applies and all that stuff. But the phrase is all the way through. And this is what's been on my heart for a while. In fact, it was on my heart for a lot of 2015, too, because the words abundant life expansion, thank you, were the two thoughts that were really in my heart for 2015. And one of the words for abundant life is the life that goes all the way through, the life that touches every other area of our life. And so as I was thinking through 2016, I think we focused a lot on life in 2015. However, one of the things that was concerning me over and over again as I met with people, as I talked with people, even as I prayed for the church as a whole, is I saw certain areas of our lives where it was fully apparent that the Lord was active. You could just see it. It was so apparent you couldn't ignore it if your eyes were closed. And then in this same person's life, another area of their life seemed totally void of the Lord. In the same person's life, you had one area where there was an exuberant, obvious presence of the Lord, and then another area of life was just a disaster. And I started, you know, really talking to the Lord about this. I said, Lord, is this just you, like, doing in one area, and you're just, you know, letting that area go for a while? And in some of the cases it was, but in most of the cases, it was the Lord says, they only let me in here. This is where the area where they felt comfortable letting me have my way. And when I can have my way, it is an abundant, beautiful experience you can have with me. But then there's these other areas of our lives where for whatever reason we just didn't welcome him in. Maybe we didn't think he was needed. I don't want to give too many examples. I want to do this on Wednesday night. But I'll give one example where I feel like there's this concept, especially among a lot of young people that I'm looking at, and there's no one in particular, so please don't think, oh, is he talking about me? Because I'm not. This is just a general statement I'm noticing, and it's really not just among young people, it's about people in general, where there's this excitement about all that God will do in our spiritual lives. Like there's this spiritual desire. It's like when, you know, we're in our lives and then we come to church on Sunday morning and we're in the presence of the Lord and we're all in, and you can just look at a life from afar and say, oh my goodness, look at the way they worship. Look at the way they prophesy. Look at the way they minister from the Lord. And it's so unbelievable. And then you go talk to them about what's going on in their job. You go talk to them about what's going on in their finances, what's going on in any one or two relationships they have. And you find that what you see here isn't happening in that area. And honestly, I asked the Lord about this because I said, I don't want to be a judge, okay? I don't want to judge wrongly here. So I'm asking you, Lord, is this just what you're doing in their lives? And almost every time, except a few cases, he said, no, I want to be in that. I want to be in that financial situation. I don't want them to suffer here unnecessarily. So the theme for this year is all the way through. That this abundant life of the Lord touches every area of our lives. It was meant to. Jesus died that we might truly live. One of the things I really would love in my lifetime to decimate is the idea that Jesus died so that you would die. There's a lot of preachers out there that are still preaching the idea that in order to walk the Christian life, you have to die to yourself. No, I actually think you need to live. There is a person on the inside of you that Jesus died to set free. I believe that's the prisoner of Isaiah 61. So the theme and the idea is all the way through. And I don't know if there's a better definition of maturity than that. Where every area of our life demonstrates the power, the life, the joy, and the presence of God. I don't want you in one area being excited, being able to come here and enjoy, and then go home and be miserable. I don't think that was meant to be the Christian life at all. So that's my desire for all of us this year. How's that sound? That sound good? So 2016, and I want to honor two things. I want to honor the Lord, first of all, for giving me December, where in Bible study we focused on wisdom. And we took Bible studies and just took the wisdom of God and applied it to some real life, everyday stuff. We applied it to finances. We applied it to family. Aaron wrote just recently, taught and applied it to our work life and our workplace. And the other one I want to credit is Tanya Eberle over there. Hi, Tanya. Can you wave to everybody? Yes, you can. No, that was the weakest wave I've ever seen. Wave at everybody. This girl over here came to me and she was really thankful. She said, I can't make your Bible studies because of work. But she said, I want to tell you, I'm really thankful because World Harvest Outreach tends to teach some pretty heavy spiritual stuff. I understand that. No, I'm sorry. I'm not really sorry. I'm not sorry at all. I just lied to you. But she says, I'm really glad that you're taking December and making it practical. And I'm like, wow, I didn't realize that it wasn't as necessarily something that was practical. And I realized that for my own life and in my own leadership, I was wondering if we were creating somewhat of a disconnect between these spiritual truths and everyday life. And so I'm asking the Lord in 2016 for us to bridge that. Let's build a bridge here. Because in reality, there is no separation between spirit and natural. I need everyone to realize this. The Bible, specifically in the New Testament, the Jewish mindset is there is no difference. There is no difference between spirit and natural. What you do in the natural has an impact in the spirit. What you do in the spirit has a complete impact in the natural. They are one. So we can't live one way and then expect it to not affect the rest. It will. So there is no spirit life, natural life. Well, my spiritual life's pretty good because I'm going to go to heaven, but my natural life, I don't want that to be our testimony in 2016. By the end of this year, I would love for us all to be able to say that at least all of, name an area of your life, because really I don't even like to say areas because that creates separation in itself. But in my life, the Lord is having his way. Amen? So, this morning, I want to kind of show you the mindset shift that has to take place in order for what we believe 2016 holds for us to happen. Okay? Did I say something funny? I don't know. All right. I'm going to be all over the place, and I'm going to try to read this without my glasses. And I believe that's Romans 5. Yep. If it's not, just open your Bible, close your eyes, and point. Romans 5, verse 20. Well, no, let's not start there. No, let's not start there. Let's start in Galatians chapter 3. Verse 23. Get there as fast as you can. I'm going to try to find my glasses. And it's a new year, which means I'm going to get new glasses this year because my insurance kicked over. So, Doc, wherever you are, get ready. You're going to see me soon. What did she say? Oh. Galatians 3, 23. Before faith came, we were kept in custody under the law. Being shut up. See, you can say shut up. It's in the Bible. Being shut up. Now, don't use that against me later. Being shut up to the faith which was later to be revealed. Therefore, the law has become our tutor to lead us to Christ so that we may be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer under a tutor. For you are all what? Sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. So, let's create... I want to create a little delineation here. This is going to sound overly simplistic at first, but as we read this, hopefully it'll become a little more revelational to us. I want to differentiate between law and grace. Here it says Christ, but the reality is that's the person that brings us grace. Grace is actually a person. His name is Jesus too. Let's read this again. Verse 24, the law became our tutor, or has become our tutor to lead us to Christ so that we may be justified by faith. Now that faith has come, we're no longer under a tutor. Really big verse, verse 25. Now that faith has come, we're no longer under a tutor. For you are all sons of God through faith in Jesus Christ. Sons don't need tutors. Why? Because sons need Father. Okay? So, you all right there? It's having voices? Okay. So, here's the thing. Now that we're no longer under the law, we're under Christ or under grace, and we're going to read how grace also fits here. The problem is, if we still live according to this, though this is in effect, there's no power in it anymore. And if we live according to the law and we wonder why it's not working, why it's not producing life for us, I just want to tell you now, at the beginning, there is no life anymore living according to the law. Sorry?
Are you talking about biblical or governmental?
Oh, I'm talking biblical.
Is that a dumb question?
No, it's not a dumb question. That's good, because I don't want you to go out there and suddenly... Let's thank you for that. Can we just all clarify that the police are still to be honored? That you should still leave here and pay your taxes by April 15th? Denver, say amen. She's even there. Thank you, Kristen. Appreciate that. This is a different law. Let's go over what that law is. This is the law that God gave to Moses on Mount Sinai. And it's not just 600 plus legal facets. It was a mindset that generations later they started living by. It was a mindset that convinced them of this simple fact, that in order to do well, you had to do well. In order to be pleasing to God, in order to have His love and His attention and the lack of punishment and penalty, you had to do things right. Hello? Yeah. Okay. And we're going to see some very specific aspects of a law mindset and how it differentiates itself from grace. Glasses. Thank you. Okay, now let's go to Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5. Come on, go with me. Are you guys all using your electronics? That's why it's so silent. Romans chapter 5, verse 20. The law came in so that the transgression would increase. Has anybody ever seen that verse before in their Bibles? Well, there you go, for those of you who have never seen it before. Isn't that crazy? That God gave, this has been in your Bible all along. You know that thing you every once in a while pull out? Oh my gosh, it's Sunday, first Sunday of the year, probably ought to grab it. It's been in here all along. The law came in so that transgression would increase. So let's just put over here. We're going to differentiate some of the things over here. Law versus grace. Sin increases. Has anybody ever noticed that in your own life? The more you try hard not to sin, the more you sin. Am I alone in the room? Yeah. Isn't that crazy? The majority of this book you carry around is considered the law, technically the Old Testament, but really, it's just an overarching shadow over the entire Old Testament is the idea of the law. And Paul tells us pretty clearly here that it actually increased our own transgressions. But where sin increased, grace abounded all the more. What? So that as sin reigned in death, death in the law, even so grace would reign through righteousness to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Give me a second here. So, one of the things I want to say. So, sin increases. So, how am I going to differentiate here? I already screwed myself up. Yeah. Well, let me just put it this way. When you sin here, sin increases. When you sin here, grace increases. Do you see this? Look at this. Here's another thing. And I'm just going to start throwing thoughts out to you, okay? I'm not going to find scriptures for all of these, but you can just trust me on this, okay? Here, under the law, what is the punishment? Death. Here, if you make a mistake, what's the punishment here? Actually, it's more grace. Didn't we just read it? So that, go back a verse. When sin increases, grace abounds all the more. So you can't, I'm going to tell you, this is going to sound totally anti everything you've been taught before, and I love it. Listen to these words, because this is in line with Scripture. The more you sin, the more grace comes. I'm just going to let that settle in because that's offending someone in this room right now. You can't lose this thing. I have heard people teach this, that the more you... Everyone is trying to teach you to stop sinning, stop sinning, stop sinning. That's the wrong message to teach people. The right message is to teach people, go ahead. I know this is going to sound so anti, you're wondering if you should ever walk in this building again. Listen. The whole point of this law, call it sin, call it death, whatever it is, that the more you walk in it, the more grace is directed towards you. I'm just going to let this settle in. If we don't understand this simple principle, we won't understand the power of grace. Now, we think right now, I can feel the room teetering right now. Because you're not sure if the preacher up here is teaching that the more you sin, the better off you'll be. If you hear that, you are hearing according to an old mentality. In fact, if you're asking me, you're listening to a law mentality. Because the goodness of God is so strong in the earth right now that he will allow someone to go to the pit of hell, the very depths of the despair of their own condition. And guess who they find there? They find the Lord. Someone should be rejoicing in this, not singing, oh my gosh, is he teaching that I should sin more? Please hear me. The whole point of grace is that you can't get away from it. It follows you. It pursues you. It surrounds you. You can't get away from grace. Sin more, it abounds more. Now, I define law for you. Maybe we should define grace for you. So you understand that it's not this greasy thing that you've heard people talk about before. The word, anybody know what the Greek word for grace is? Charis. Charis. It's where we get the word charisma. Charismatic. Right? Okay. The word charis means this. It means the divine. Who is the divine? God, Jesus, the Father, the Lord. The Lord's divine influence where? On the heart. Now you think about this for a minute. The way we've always heard grace in the past, and I know I was one taught like this for a long time, is that grace comes in and just says, oh, it's okay. I come in from the outside and I just say, it's okay. Grace is not this way. That's what the law did. The law came in from the outside and protected you. It kept you safe. In fact, let's go ahead and write that up there right now. Where's my black pen? The law keeps you. It sounds nice. Look, I like to be kept. Anybody else? Protect me. Hallelujah. Law, protect me. But honestly, grace does something better. Grace empowers you. And here's the problem. Many of us live a life with God that we just want to be kept. Keep me from harm. Take care of me, God. Fulfill your promise concerning me. Hello? I want to tell you, that is a law, Old Testament mindset. The promise of God is himself. If you have what you would call promises of God, God promised me this, God promised me that, God promised me something, that is an Old Testament law way of looking at the Lord. That is not the grace. That is no longer what you are under anymore. I'm going to break your heart a little bit today. The promise of for you is the Lord, and the promise of the Lord is you. What grace does, it's the divine influence of the Lord upon our heart. If you look at it a little deeper, tear up the word charis, it actually means it's God's life coming inside of us and empowering us from the inside out. It's meant to do this. The law kept us from actually the anger of the Lord. They would go in once a year. Anybody know this? The priest would go in once a year. They would tie a rope to him because if the Lord wasn't pleased, he would die and they'd have to drag him out because they weren't allowed to go in. Okay? The law kept us. Grace reminds us that we're empowered from the inside. That's why I say to you, the more you sin, the more empowerment you get. If you think of this as the more you sin, the more forgiveness you get, you're not thinking of grace. Grace, as it has been taught for way too long, is not just, oh, it'll be okay, get up and try again. No, grace is actually, you know what? You messed up. You need more of me. And then God comes in and burrows himself inside. He actually draws nearer in that way, not just nearer like a blanket. No, nearer like in you. Did you want to say something, Barbara?
Well, and what I'm hearing you say is the law is fear-based. If you're kept in your, you're stuck in your whatever, it's fear-based. And in the church, we've lived in fear for years. We've lived in fear of making a mistake, fear of this, fear of that. But I'm hearing you say grace says risk. Risk life with loving, risk doing everything that we're called.
That's beautiful.
It's so free, it's so empowering.
Yeah, beautiful. Yeah, there's no. Let's just go ahead and write that down. Law is fear-based. You do things and don't do things out of what might or might not happen. Anybody? Grace is faith-based. You're doing things out of what could happen. Now there's an anticipation of life. Does anybody anticipate what will happen if you walk according to the ways of the Lord? It's not, I walk according to the ways of the Lord so bad things won't happen. I walk according to his heart because of what could happen. Good consequences versus bad. Come on. All right, I got some other verses here. I actually have verses. Romans chapter 3, not that far back. Romans 3:19. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law. Is anybody in here under the law? Huh? Okay, I need this to be really clear. It sounds like there's some hesitation here. Before I go into what I was about to say, please don't let me get away from Romans 3. The law was fulfilled in Jesus. Okay? He literally swallowed it up inside of himself. Okay? It's one of the reasons why it scares me when we still carry around an Old and a New Testament. Because we tend to not read the Old Testament through grace. We still read the Old Testament for the words that are on the page. And the concern I have as a father, as a leader, as just one of your brothers, is that you will live according to the words of the law and expect the recompense that's resulting from it. But now we are under grace. I need you guys to hear this. And because of that, we now look at the Old Testament through the eyes of Jesus or grace or even the New Testament as a whole. And as we look at the Old Testament, if you're not careful, you will live an Old Testament lifestyle when you're under grace. I think one of the greatest reasons why we are disappointed with the Lord is we live under the law. So many of us in this room have experienced disappointment of the Lord. Come on. Has anybody ever been disappointed in the Lord before? Oh, I have been. The reason why so many of us are is we think that because we do something, he should. Hello? That's law. If he says something, then I go and do it. Hello? That's law. What? Yes. We still have this idea that we're servants and slaves. And here's what makes it worse is that Paul calls himself one. We don't understand the mindset that Paul's speaking from when he says this. He was the chief of sinners, he called himself. Do you remember that? He was the one who was overseeing and decreeing the death of Christians. So when Jesus apprehends him, lays hold of him, he feels like the prodigal son. Does anybody remember what the prodigal son said when he said, I'm going to come back to my father? I'm not even worthy to be called your son. I'll just be a servant in the house. That's exactly how Paul felt. And that's why he uses those words. But it's Paul here who in Romans 5 says that because of faith we are what? sons of God through Christ Jesus. Hello? All right. So, Romans 3:19. Look at this. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be closed and all the world may become accountable to God. Because by the works of the law, no flesh will be justified in his sight. No flesh justified. No one is justified under the law. All of us are guilty in the law. For through the law comes the knowledge of sin. Now look, here's the good part. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. In other words, the law and the prophets look at Jesus and say yes and amen. Even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all those who believe, there is no distinction. Look at this. Everybody knows this verse, right? For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Look at these next two words. Being justified. That being justified applies to that first or second word of 23, the word all. In the law, no flesh is justified. In grace, all are justified. I don't know why you're not excited about that. That should be really exciting. That means your friend, do you hear this? Your friend who has not heard your words yet. Your friend who is still doing whatever they want to do, living however they want to live, according to their own law. Your college buddy, your coworker, your dear friend, sister, whatever you want to call it. I want you to know, she's already justified. She's already forgiven. The blood of Jesus has already been shed on their behalf. Does that mean they're already saved? Everybody say, no. They're already forgiven. They're already justified. That means grace is abounding where? Toward them. Guys, this is as easy as giving candy to a kid. Here's the problem. Has anybody struggled to bring the gospel to somebody? Raise your hand if it has been a difficult prospect for you to share the gospel with somebody. I'll tell you why. Because we come at it from this. If we come at them recognizing that grace is already abounding to them. In fact, the more that they sin, the more grace abounds to them. Where's the grace? The grace that comes within them to empower who they really are, to shine forth on the inside of them, right? We know that the love of God is already upon them. We know that the Holy Spirit is convicting them concerning what? Sin, righteousness, and judgment. All of this is happening without you. Now, what we get to do, we don't have to tell them anything that they're doing wrong. We don't have to convince them of anything. You know what we get to do? Because he's doing all these things, we get to just love them. The problem is, we try to layer on something over here in the law. Hey, what is it? Somewhere along the line, the four spiritual laws? And the Romans Road and all these things. We actually layered on people these processes by which they become whatever it is we're supposed to become. And the reality is they already are it. All of this is already happening in their lives. All we're doing is our love is awakening them to it. I think didn't you put it on there about who put true love's kiss? Who was talking about true love's kiss? Someone was talking about, was that Gabby? Yeah. He must have been watching too many Disney movies. The reality is, every human being is simply waiting for true love's kiss. And the kiss actually already happened 2,000 years ago. But now we get to be these beautiful, lip-smacking versions of Christ in the earth. Where have we lost it? Where did we miss out on the fact that we don't have to tell them what they're doing wrong and convince them of what to do right? We have to love them. And that love parallels with grace already working in their lives, and it awakens them. But when we layer on them what they should be doing, it's dissonant to what the Lord's doing in them. And it causes a disconnect that they can't, and they'll actually pull away from you. Does that happen to anybody? We have to join grace. We're not under the law anymore. We're under grace. And do you ever wonder why maybe the Lord's not active in your life like you'd like Him to be? Could the same disconnect be taking place? You're trying. You're performing. And your spirit disconnects with that trying and performing because grace is abounding towards you. Yet you're trying to walk according to something that life is no longer in. It's in grace now. And grace is divinely empowering you from the inside. I want to tell you something. I have become more like Christ in surrender than ever in trying. How are we doing? Is this okay? Romans chapter 7. I'll tell you what. If you want to know, if you want to see the Old Testament properly, read Romans. Romans will show you how to see the Old Testament properly. There is so much Old Testament scripture in Romans, and it will give you a much better understanding of the gospel in the Old Testament. Romans chapter 7. Verse 4. Therefore, my brethren, you also were made to die to the law through the body of Christ. See, you don't have to die. Jesus died your death for you to everything you need to die to. Hello? This should be really exciting to some of you. So that you might be joined to one another. Whoa! We can't get away from one another. We can't go hole up and say, just me and Jesus, I'll be okay. Nope. You are joined to me. I don't care if you like me or not. You're joined to me. And the same thing applies to me. There are some people that I would just rather not be joined to. I'm going to be honest with you. I'm like, can I be the pinky toe and they be the left ear? You know, can we have that kind of distance? And the Lord says, you're all joined. I'm like, okay, more grace, more grace, more grace. Look at this. He keeps going. So that you might be joined to one another, to Him who was raised from the dead, in order that we might bear fruit for God. Here's a big one. Here's a big one. In the Old Testament, we want to eat fruit. According to the law, just give me fruit, God. I need fruit. A lot of the Christians walking around today have their mouths open like little baby birds waiting for God to drop a worm in. We are looking to be fed when we're supposed to be bearing. Under the law, we want to eat fruit. This is one of the greatest ways we're disappointed by the Lord. We want the Lord to feed us. I'm going to get real with you. Can I just get real with you? We are waiting for the Lord to do things that are on the inside of us to do. We are waiting for the Lord to do things that He's already done in Christ in us. I'm about to go a little mature on you, okay? I'm not saying we're there yet, but I'm saying that this is the desire of the Lord. Way back in the Old Testament, in Deuteronomy, this little verse buried inside of Deuteronomy, it says this, that He has given us the power to produce wealth. Hello? To create it. It's on the inside of us. That's abundance. That we're waiting for someone to send a check in the mail. Hmm. on the inside of us is the throne of heaven. Hello? Jesus enthroned on our hearts. Yet we're waiting for someone else to pray for our healing. We can't live according to this anymore and expect power and life to be flowing in our lives. We, this is what Romans 7 just says. Let me read this again just so you guys can make sure you see this. To him who was raised, wait a minute, no, wait. Let's just get this all together. Blah, blah, blah. You were made to die to the law through Jesus so that you might be joined to one another, that's us, and to Jesus who was raised from the dead. Now, when he was raised from the dead, that means he's what? Alive, right? He's alive, which means we are raised to life in order that we might bear fruit for God. On the inside of us is the same resurrection life. You guys know this. I don't have to preach this to you. That raised Christ Jesus from the dead. Romans 7 or 8 tells us this. He who raised Christ Jesus from the dead, he gives life to our mortal bodies. It's in us. And I got to tell you, there's got to be a groan in heaven every time we reach out for someone else to help us when it's in us. It's right here. And I'm not saying we don't rely upon one another because we need one another. We do. But there's also when we become dependent upon one another. Looking for what's already been done in us. You guys all right? Yeah. Let's keep going in Romans 7. Just jump down because I'm... what time is it? Is it late? Oh, yeah. Sorry. Oh, goodness. What shall we say then? Verse 7. Is the law sin? Paul had the same questions being asked to him. Oh, so we just keep sinning and everything will be okay? On the contrary, may it never be. I would not have come to know sin except through the law. There it is again. For I would have not known about coveting if the law had not said, you shall not covet. Look at that. But sin taking an opportunity through the commandment. Look, the more you try, the more sin will take an opportunity through the very thing you're trying. It's looking for that opportunity. Produced in me coveting of every kind. For apart from the law, sin is dead. So here in the law, you arouse sin. I'm going to tell you right now. Any area of your life where you try to create a law, you will arouse the very appetite that you're trying to put down. Hello? Name an area of your life. Spiritual, natural, whoops, sorry, I did it too. Any area of your life, the more you try to set in place laws and rules to live by, I promise you, the more you will arouse the very appetite you're trying to put down. We'll talk about that. I got a whole message on that. You sure you want to hear that right now? But if you live by grace, you arouse more grace. This is a really hard word for some people. Because some of us are really struggling in some areas of our lives. Be it addiction, be it, I don't know, diet, fitness, emotional abuse, whatever it is. There's all kinds of situations here. And I'm not going to stand here and try to solve all of your problems for you standing here. I'm not going to try to answer all of your questions here, but I will tell you this. If you live according to law, you will die. Yep. That I know for sure. You will ride the roller coaster of life over and over and over again. You'll get real serious and you'll lay down the law for yourself and you will say, I will not do this again, I will not do this again. And then I'm doing it again, I'm doing it again. Oh my goodness, and you're doing the loop-de-loop. Yep. Who's lived it? There's a better way. And it's to walk according to grace. It doesn't matter what area of your life, name it. Grace can abound there. But if you live according to the law, grace cannot abound there. And then you will wonder why you keep failing. Because you have not allowed grace. to live there. This is one of the things I noticed. Remember in, I forget where it is right now, but John the Baptist's disciples come to Jesus and go, hey, I want to know why your disciples don't fast. Remember that? Remember Jesus' reply? There'll be a time where I won't be with them. But while I'm with them, why would you fast? Let's rejoice. Let's eat and let's drink and let's be merry together. We're together. We're celebrating life. There'll be a day where I won't be with them. Now, here's the deal. Most of us think that that word is premonitive of him leaving the earth and going back to heaven. That is not true. He's speaking of the 3 days. Ooh, it got quiet in the house. That's when he wasn't with them. Oh, he's with us now. He's been with us ever since he resurrected. He is with us right now. But here's the deal. We think, and I know this is flying in the face of some things. I know it is. We can talk about it if you want to. But I promise you this. If you fast to get your flesh in line, if you fast to get your flesh in line, you will feed it. Fasting is not to get your flesh in line. In fact, I don't see a lot of New Testament command for fasting. What I see is the desire for you to walk with the Spirit, and that becomes a fasted lifestyle. So we think if we fast, if I cut out this and cut out that and cut out TV and cut out this and cut out that, then I'll walk by the Spirit. No. All you're doing is learning how to walk without other stuff. No. If you would learn to walk with and by the Spirit, then you'll be able to see the TV according to the Spirit. You'll be able to see food according to the Spirit. Why are we separating things? Jesus has brought it together and says, walk in this world with me. Hello? This is why one area of our life is abounding and full. Another area of your life is a constant disappointment. Hello? I hope you're hearing it today. I got more on the law. I got to finish up because I know it's late. Words to read. In fact, words to memorize. Man, these guys had to memorize it. Here, letters to become. We're not supposed to be reading Scripture and memorizing Scripture. We're supposed to become it. We're supposed to be living epistles of the life of Jesus. In everyday life, name it, be it in the kitchen, be it in the classroom, be it on the line at work, being it in the office, you are a living letter of Jesus people are reading. Not you going, we're living according to the law if we're trying to do. I'm not saying don't read this. I read this probably as much, if not more than most of you. But my desire is not to learn it. My desire is to live it. Jesus became the very thing we're still trying to memorize. If we would just live with the Word, you wouldn't need to memorize it. I love you. Last one. I got more on here, but I'm just going to finish this one up. Oh, that's going to leave a mark. Living according to the law maintains our slavery. Living according to grace brings forth our sonship. I was talking to Gabby from Italy about a month or two ago. We were talking about this very thing here called sonship. And for a lot of people still in this room today, that word sonship is like, what? What are you talking about? He actually put it this way. He goes, you know, talking about sonship in the church right now is like talking about unicorns and rainbows to people in the world. And he's absolutely right. We're still so caught up in being followers and believers that we have no idea that the whole point of belief was to bring us into sonship. Bring us into the understanding that we're actually of the same lineage Jesus is. To walk as the Father, as the Son in the earth is actually not just our identity, it's our inheritance. If you just want to wait for God to tell you to do something and then do it, fine, but I will promise you there's no life in it. You will be empty and void, and then you'll eventually become addicted to having someone tell you what to do. If you don't hear the Lord, then you'll ask someone that kind of represents him in your life. And before long, someone's got to tell me what to do. If I don't know what to do, I can't do anything, then I'm not pleasing to God. Blah, blah, blah. Or you can rest in the fact that I'm a son. And because grace is within me, the divine influence and empowerment upon my heart, he is actually influencing my thought life. He's influencing the way I see and perceive the world. And before long, my thoughts are his thoughts. My ways are his ways. Mark, that's not what scripture says. Go back and read it. He's speaking to the unrighteous, wicked man. Where my thoughts are not your thoughts and my ways not your ways. He's not talking to a guy walking in grace. He's not talking to one who's allowing the grace of God to influence his heart and life. You don't need someone to tell you what to do. In fact, you don't need the Lord to tell you what to do. Look at that. No lightning bolt. No lightning bolt. He does not want to cause you to become an addict to his commands. That was law. Grace is, I come inside of you, Stacy, and I grow who you really are inside of you. And Christ in you will operate according to my nature and my character. And I get to just walk with you. You guys hear this? This is how we were supposed to live. You get to live this way. You get to. You know what? Angels in heaven right now are rejoicing over what I've just said. I just want you to know that. They are really, really excited. And you know why they're excited? They can't live this way. But they know that they have been tasked by him to make sure we do. And as long as we live like angels, we'll never be sons. So, Lord, I pray that 2016 be a year we grow up. That we would take seriously what it means to be a son through faith in Christ Jesus. I want to be your brother, Jesus. I'm really thankful that you're my Lord. I'm thankful that you did what I could not do on my own. I'm thankful that you made me free. But now I'm really thankful that I get to walk with you in the earth. I get to walk like you, as you in the earth. And I'm no longer a child who's tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. And by every time someone comes along with a strong word, I live that way for a while until someone comes along with another word that's totally different. And I live that way for a while. No, I'm a son. And a son arises to the full measure which belongs to the stature of Christ. And we know who we are in the earth. And we will love like you love. And we will live like you live. And our lives will have great meaning and depth. And will have a lasting influence on the generations to come. That's the life we have been given in this abundant life. Father, I ask that every area of our life would experience this. Every relationship experience this. All the way through. Thank you for grace. Thank you that you saw in your wisdom to not just do it all for us. What wisdom you had in that. Thank you that you now want to do with us what you didn't do for us. And I honor you, Lord. And may a generation arise in the earth that truly walks as you do. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's have a great 2016, huh? I love y'all. Wednesday night, 7 o'clock, Vision.